up and the ability to play a control game,
right.
structurally play a control game against very aggressive beatdown decks.
Yeah, the glaring removal aspect, the package is that it goes to the face, which is much different than Esper, where you have no reach in a deck like that to play a mid-range deck like that. So I do like the red here.
So on your right, you see John Rolfe, who we had on camera earlier today. He's playing Jund. He's on the play as the third seed, and he leads off with a Blood Crypt and a Woodland Cemetery and...
Looks like a Farseek. I guess he's thinking about what land to get here. Yeah, he's a lot of times people will Farseek and just grab a land out and, you know, sort of know what they want. I like looking at the hand, making sure you grab the right one.
Yeah, and it's actually a little bit tricky with these Jund decks at times because they have Mizzium Mortars, Garruk Relentless, and possibly double black spells. So these Farseeks, even though they seem pretty straightforward, are actually pretty tricky because the deck is fairly color intensive.
Right, yeah. Triple green Planeswalker going with a triple red Wrath effect is pretty tricky at times to get. We see John with possibly a Huntmaster here. They always have it after the Farseek, right? Oh, no, we have three, which is going to be for good old Lifebane Zombie. John is opting to play four, as we discussed earlier. And again, he's going to go with a guaranteed hit against his Flash deck, because this happens to have a lot more creatures than the average Flash deck does.
Yeah, normally you'd be only looking at four copies of Restoration Angel maximum in these blue-white-red Flash decks as target. Ben's edition of Geist of Saint Traft in the main deck,
right,
and Boros Reckoner. He has many more targets than the conventional blue-white-red Flash deck.
Definitely, and I think you take Geist here, right? I would just be petrified to play against that Jund. I don't see him having a Wrath effect in his hand. I see a couple of Rakdos return. I don't see him wanting to play against Geist, but he's going to take out the rest of Angel. So we'll see how this goes. Because if he plays Geist and then Warlier's Helix is the 3-1, if John doesn't have a Thragtusk Chump, the answer is going to be kind of tricky.
I believe John has a fifth land and a Bonfire in hand, so he's okay. Not particularly concerned about Geist's same track.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. So I didn't see the Bonfire. All right, let's see what we got here. We're going to play Geist, of course. If John does have this, he will definitely, I think he'll bond. Well, he doesn't need it in his hand when it's already there. He did have it too, so yeah, he's got answers for days.
Right. And I mean, John's play that last turn is such a strong representation of having Bonfire already in hand that if I was Ben, I wouldn't be too terribly upset here. The writing was kind of on the wall that this was...
Yeah, and Ben, he has a deck where Bonfire is not going to absolutely destroy him every time, because most of the time, one of these creatures alone can really carry the workload in Reckoner and Thundermaw Hellkite, so it's not like you're going to be hitting 2, 3, 4 for ones here, you know?
Yeah. And Scavenging Ooze to finish up the turn, so...
I think Ben needs to forget Resto Angel at this point and use a removal spell. He has a Searing Spear and a Snapcaster, so he can easily Searing Spear, Scavenging Ooze, and then the next turn Snapcaster and rebuy a removal spell. I don't think you want to let Scavenging Ooze get out of control.
Yeah, he's a little bit behind on the board. He should be probably using a little bit of his removal to catch up here. Again, an opportunity a couple turns to advance his board, maybe actually set up Snapcaster plus Restoration Angel somewhere down the line.
Exactly, yeah.
And so I'm in your camp of using some sequencing of removal to stave off the pressure that John's developed here, and then eventually start doing your Snapcaster Restoration Angel type.
Absolutely. And as long as Scavenging Ooze is in play, the Snapcasters are pretty much dead cards in Ben's hand unless he gets it out of play here. Let's see what John answers with. Obviously, he has a couple. I think he has two Rakdos return, which is going to be. Yeah, he definitely has two and a Bonfire. This is him. That is such a good card right here because we know Ben has no counter spells.
Well, Ben actually has two main deck copies of Dissipate. Yeah. The coast is reasonably clear from John's perspective. Again, players in the elimination rounds get to see each other's deck lists.
Right.
So he knows that there's not a ton of draws that Ben has, but there have been a couple turns since that Lifebane Zombie got cast. There's no guarantee
that there
is not a Dissipate list.
But luckily, when you have two of those in your hand, you're willing to just dump one right off the bat, see if it gets countered. If it does, you're pretty much going to resolve the second one.
Yeah. So John, aware of the Restoration Angel in hand because of the earlier Lifebane Zombie, unwilling to send that Scavenging Ooze, just testing the waters with his Intimidate creature.
Right, and I think Ben takes this. It's pretty guaranteed here. He takes this, and then end of turn, he can Helix to gain back any life loss, but he's going to opt for the Searing Spear. I don't like this play because Scavenging Ooze can eat it, and it stops the Snapcaster plan, or John's obviously going to just now easily land a Rakdos return here. without any threat of dissipate.
Yeah, he's fairly exposed here if John decides to fire this off, and that scavenging ooze again, like you mentioned.
Yeah, here it comes.
So many creatures in the graveyard, so many spells to break up with Snapcaster Mage. This is.
Right. Yeah, he's gonna have to, and that's for all but one card. It looks like.
I believe that Ben probably just needs to keep Snapcaster Mage here to go Snapcaster Mage, Searing Spear,
right.
And then he has a number of pretty powerful draws and a creature in play to apply some pressure.
Yeah, it's definitely better to have a Snapcaster in play rather than just gaining 4 life on the Helix, I think. I like that better. So I think he's going to take your advice. He's obviously flicking between the two cards there to see which one he wants to keep. We know that John has a second bonfire, so Snapcaster won't be long for this world.
Okay, it looks like he's leaning on the side of keeping the Helix, but I don't mind that. I would err towards keeping the Snapcaster, but it's
right. Yeah,
I believe he kept something else out of there. I don't know if he's.
I can't see anything he could possibly keep besides those two cards. Hopefully, he didn't. He kept Snapcaster, okay. He had 2 Snapcasters, yeah.
Okay.
Here comes the spear. John is in great shape. He's going to return that last card in his hand. And, I mean, not great shape, but he definitely got his money's worth on that return.
Yeah. The second return, obviously much less powerful than the first one. And again, you know, Ben's deck is structured a lot differently than the average blue-white-red flash deck. Besides having Restoration Angel as draws, he still has Geists, Reckoners, Thundermaw Hellkites, still lacking a fifth land, but the point is, he actually can go from 0 to 60 in a much different velocity than...
Right. He hit that Thundermaw Hellkite. That was the card that Ben drew. That's pretty, pretty good. John goes to the safe life total of 18. Ben plays his land. He doesn't want you to return a third time, even though there's no possibility of that. But, you know, might as well play it.
Well, he has Bonfire in the deck, so...
He does have the Bonfire, right?
Might as well play your land.
I'm not a big land bluffer anyway. I like to play my lands, my land drops. Alright, so John is staring down a Snapcaster Mage. Easily has the answers in hand. I don't think you Bonfire here. I think you obviously wait. I would definitely not slip the Snapcaster here. He's afraid maybe of a Resto Angel.
No, I respect that play. I mean, again, he's aware of the deck list. He has to be conscious of his life total. It's not...
Yeah, I just like the Bonfire for the burn aspect out of the hand. And doing it for 3 seems pretty good, putting him at 6, and then it leads him to a lethal return and or Bonfire.
You see
and draws Olivia here. I think you take 2 maybe one more time, 2 more times.
So Olivia off the top for John. Available to apply a little bit more pressure. And again, we know Bonfire's in hand, so they're getting into range of lethal is important.
And passing turn is going to be pretty big for John, because putting him at 6 now creates a slew of problems. We know that Farseek will now leave a Bonfire for, let's see, 1, 2, 3. He draws a landing Bonfire for 4. But the 3 Bonfire will be lethal with one more Olivia swing.
Ben draws.
We know how good Olivia is versus creature decks, too. I mean, Geist obviously is hard to ping, aka impossible. But Olivia is good against the rest of the dudes in this deck. I see a lot of red cards in Ben's hand. I'm not sure what he has.
Yeah, it looks like he has multiple red removal spells, but he only has the 1 silver ball, so he can't cast them all in one turn. He can't cast multiple removal spells in one turn.
Right, yeah. If he says go, this probably will be the ball game unless it's a Searing Spear in his hand, which will save Ben momentarily. Ben's thinking, if you're at 6, you cannot take this damage. But he will, and he will die to a Bonfire here if John chooses to go for the win. I can see saying go too, because then Ben is stuck with dealing with Olivia and that. But the danger in that is if he draws Warrior's Helix, then he gets back out of range.
Yeah.
So I think you play into his 2 dissipates. As John does a Haymaker deck anyway, but he's not going to. So let's see if that will be a punishing blow for John here. I don't think he has a Warrior's Helix.
So no, it would have almost certainly been cast last turn. So yeah.
He does have 5 mana for Bonfire for 2, and he's going to Pillar Olivia. John, you cannot ping your own guy here, so he will be put in the graveyard after this. And John will show him the Bonfire. And they'll be moving to game 2 here.
Okay. And what we saw there, you know, Ben's deck, not a Delver deck, of course, but it has a lot of the similar aspects of Delver decks from last season, where when it gets out in front of you, it's a very powerful deck because so many of its tools are so powerful to be using proactively. When it's not able to get out in front, when it's trying to play defense and fend off the opposing offense with its spells and not being able to leverage its advantage on the board, then it's much more anemic. And you saw in that game, John was able to, he was on the play with Farseek.
Right.
So immediately he's way ahead in leveraging his resources. And it's much more awkward for Ben to be sort of fending off when he's not applying his own pressure. And he never got into that spot, in part because of the opening that John had.
And it's tough to even... Being behind in mana is one thing, being behind in tempo is one thing, but getting returned back-to-back is going to be pretty much lights out for any deck that has any kind of hiccup in their plays, like we saw there. So, it kind of put him in a situation where if he has Warlier's Helix against that Olivia, we actually have a game again. But actually, it looked pretty impressive. It looked like he actually came back to an even board state when he was holding the Jund player had Tragic Slip and Bonfire. He had Snapcaster, and he was drawing on the top. We could have actually seen a real match brew there, but sadly for him, he didn't draw any spells and cast.
Yeah, absolutely. So, as we are wont to do during the elimination rounds of our Standard and Legacy tournaments, we give out 3 months of premium.
Okay.
In the quarterfinals, we give out 3 months, then half a year, and then a year. We give you a question, which you have to respond to at SCG Live and hashtag SCG Premium, and a winner will be drawn at random. It's not the first person to respond, so you don't have to worry about being the first one there. But out of the correct answers, we draw one, and that person receives 3 free months of Starseed Premium.
Sounds good.
The question that we have is, there is a singleton red spell in Ben Drexler's deck not commonly associated with blue-white-red flash decks. Again, answer that. Source, what's that red card? To SCG Live and hashtag SCG Premium, and the winner will receive 3 free months of premium. So, with that out of the way, let's take a look at some sideboard action.
All right, well, from John's list, we got, of course, Standard Jumbo has the 4 lifebane zombies. Obviously, much better in this blue red white matchup than in most control decks, so I think we leave all 4 of those in. He has a 3rd Rector's Return. I don't know if you bring that in against a deck that has a lot of 3s and 2s and 4s, but I think it's pretty good in this matchup, to be honest. I would actually bring that in. You have a Bonfire of the Damned, not too bad against the deck. Deals with Geist St. Traff, where a lot of your target removal can't deal with it. And then, of course, we have 3 Liliana of the Veil, the best card dealing with Geist St. Traff, especially with a deck with very little creatures. It's pretty tough to beat when you play turn 3 Reckoner and or Geist, whichever one you play, and they play Liliana to answer it, you're in a real world of hurt there.
Yeah, absolutely. On the other side, Ben has a couple nice additions for this matchup. He has a single clone. I like clone a lot against Jund. They have a lot of very powerful creatures to copy.
Me too.
He has another copy of Searing Spear, very good answer to Olivia and to Scavenging Ooze. He has a singleton Assemble the Legion. We've seen Assemble the Legion be varying degrees of effective against Jund over the course of the day, but I think on the play you certainly want it. And then he has access to 2 negates. We've seen a lot of people against Jund in post-board games bring in either Duresses or Sin Collectors or Negates. Jund, not really a deck you'd associate with being that spell-heavy, but almost all of its powerful action post-board involves spells and not creatures, so a lot of people bring in anti-spell hate in post-board games. So he has a variety of pretty attractive options he can go to here. I think the Clone, the Searing Spear, the Assembled Legion, and potentially the Aetherling, the most... powerful seeming to me.
Yeah, I hope you get to Aetherling. That's definitely an inclusion here. Jund has almost no way to deal with Aetherling. The few matches I beat Jund with back in the day was on the back of Aetherling. It's an answer to Garrett, any Planeswalker. You can outrace multiple Thragtusks with 8 damage unblockable, and it actually gives this deck with no Sphinx of Revelation an outlet to use all their mana to put a huge clock on their opponent. And talk about top decks. If you're ever in that situation, you draw an Aetherling, you're not losing that game.
And I really like one copy of Aetherling in sideboards like this, even though it's seemingly kind of random. For the same reason that I like one copy of Obsidat in a lot of these sideboards, is your post-board games, your opponent is generally going to be bringing in removal or planeswalkers or other tools to slow the game down. And in a slow game that's very removal-based, cards like Obsidat and Aetherling are very powerful. So those cards aren't necessarily just for straight-up control decks. They're for probably all but your fastest opponents, kind of regardless of the specifics of their deck, because your post-board games are likely to be a lot slower. Both you and your opponent are bringing in more reactive elements, and having powerful fives and sixes are good in general, and particularly ones that are resistant to removal.
Right, right. And like you said, when we're bringing in this, I definitely would bring in the Serious Spear. What do you think about Blastus Act against this deck, maybe as a one of, banking on the fact of Boris Reckoner? I kind of don't like it because a lot of removal is in Jund, and it's hard to stick a Boris Reckoner, but that damage can really knock out a Jund player who takes a lot already.
Yeah, I think the difficulty is that Jund has a lot of very good answers to Boris Reckoner. He even has four copies of Lifebane Zombie, so not only does he have more ways to attack Boros Reckoner, he also gets information on when Blasphemous Act is in the hand.
Right.
I do think there are builds of Jund where that could be a valid path to take, but I think the specifics of Jund's deck, if I was in Ben's position, I would not want to be bringing in Blasphemous Act.
Right. It would be more for our entertainment than actual effectiveness,
yeah.
I think.
But I think against Mono Red, against Naya, against decks where Blasphemous Act is naturally good and Boros Reckoner is resistant to most of their tools,
right.
I think that combination is very powerful to bring in, but I think Jund has too many ways to break up both sides of it, and not that so many creatures that where Blasphemous Act is naturally going to be a powerful
tool. Yeah, you're paying a lot of mana for that against Jund. Yeah. Because their creatures are so efficient, they need one or two out max, and then they're fine. They're good to go. So.
And look at the creatures that Jund has access to. Lifebane Zombie has value when it comes into play. Same with Huntmaster. Thragtusk, obviously resistant to removal. These are not threats that are naturally susceptible to Blasphemous Act.
Right, right.
Over in the other match, we have...
We have Devin, who won game one, and he is battling with red-green-white. Naya aggro with four Domri, very similar to a lot of the decks we've been seeing over the weekend, utilizing the massive amount of mana dorks on turn one to play their turn two Domri or turn two Lachsan Spider, the Reckoner.
That is our backup camera match, so if this match concludes before that one does, we will be moving over to the second and potentially third game of that match.
It looks like they have drawn their opening hands. They're now ready to go.
And it'll be interesting to see if Ben can do a little bit better of a job of getting out on the front foot and then being able to leverage his removal and tempo than he was in the first game, where he was on the draw, nothing to do early on in the game. Jund had a Farseek and just leveraged his resource advantage into an easy win.
You know, and I'm not against, think about Ben's play here. What if he has turn two negate, which he boards in, right, on a Farseek, and then untap plays Reckoner, you really swayed the game, I think, in your direction. I think tempo is super important in this matchup. Like you said, he has Geist in his hand, so if he has a negate here and Jund goes to Farseek, I would 100% negate that Farseek.
There's this untapped zombie ground, and he's going to attempt to land a Farseek.
We'll see if we have the negate. If he does, I'd use it. If not, what can you do? And he's allowed to go, so I'm assuming he does not have it. We see double Huntmaster in his hand, which is obviously very good against Geist and Traft and other ground creatures. Not so much against the Boros Reckoner, though.
Still fine.
Still not bad.
Still fine, but...
First strike is pretty rough against those fellows.
Yeah, and Jund's deck very well set up to handle Geist of Saint Traft. I had to feel this is one of the matchups where Ben's particular take on Blue White Red is probably behind your conventional build.
Is that Thalia's hand? Yeah, Thalia's deck. Never mind. This is some white card I see as a wrestler.
And Ben is going straight beat downs with an end of turn Snapcaster Mage.
And that's fine. He plays four Snapcaster. A lot of time you're not going to have instants in your graveyard, and we know he has a three drop creature, so we know he's going into Snapcaster Geist. This could be a disaster if Bonfire is on top of his nut. I think he has one in his hand, which lowers it to two miracle chances. But then again, one more land, and that Bonfire will do exactly what he needed to do in the first place.
So we see a Huntmaster of the Fells that's going to bring Jund up to 18 life and make a wolf. Huntmaster lines up very nicely against Geist. And we're going to see how much additional pressure Ben can add here.
All right, we have a few results coming in. Sean Wehi has defeated Jade Morrow 2-0. Alex Moriyama has defeated Tyler Oregoi 2-0 as well. So Alex, which we saw earlier playing Jund, they look like they pretty much got some easy 2-0s here.
Yep.
So they're going to await the winners of our camera matches. So the Huntmaster, like predicted, puts a halt on Geist St. Traft. He's thinking if he has a fourth land, he can resto it in combat, which is cool in a lot of formats, and it's cool in the flash deck, but here it's not very effective. He does not have a fourth land, though.
Yeah, Ben's a little bottlenecked on mana. It looks like he has multiple copies of Searing Spear, but he can't slog through this Huntmaster of the Fells.
Right.
With the two Searing Spears, because he's missing his fourth land.
The Reckoner is actually pretty decent bonfire protection here, too, for a two anyway. He's going to bonfire for two that kills his Huntmaster, just to redirect it. Do you think John still does it here to get rid of the dangerous Geist on board?
I think it's really rough to bonfire for two now that Reckoner is in play, because that shoots down the Huntmaster, and then, you know that Ben's hand's got to be all spells. He missed a land drop.
Right.
He gets to untap and attack you with his Reckoner. I just think that that's too risky of a line, given that Ben's hand is all action.
I agree. I think, and also you have to assume Ben's holding a massive amount of creatures. Oh, we're about to find out. Because Turn 2 Soundcaster kind of represents a lack of spells.
So we see a Duress here.
All creatures, as we've talked about. Creature, creature, creature.
There was a Searing Spear in his hand, which you see in his graveyard now.
Right.
Two Thunder Maws and a Restoration Angel.
Good hit by John to get the spell. It looks like now we're going to be playing a fourth land in either an Olivia Voldoran, we have a Dreadbore, and we have another Huntmaster. Yeah, I think there's a Scavenging Ooze also.
John's going to fall to 16.
I think it's clear Olivia here, right? Just getting that
you
presence
know the,
here.
You know the coast is clear. I like landing Olivia here while you know there's no removal spell.
He's going to
solidify his board a little bit more with another Huntmaster.
Yeah, Huntmaster's cool. I think Olivia untapping, pinging, putting in 4 toughness and then 5. I don't know. I don't think he has an answer for a 5/5.
John is very heavily exposed to bonfire here, and you saw Ben just point at the top of his deck.
Yeah. It's a risk. I think he just drew Warrior's Helix.
Yeah, which is the worst draw in the deck by quite a margin here, as now it is going to allow both Huntmasters to flip, and Ben can make no play to advance his board here.
No, I think what Ben does, I think he has to attack with team here, maybe not the Reckoner, and then Resto Angel the Geist on his turn to stop the Huntmasters from flipping.
Well, he's not even going to be able to play his Restoration Angel. He's missing a fourth land. So
oh, yeah, you're right.
This was a disastrous draw for Ben.
Yeah, sorry, I completely forgot. We talked about his lack of ability to develop a board state because of Mana of the Game 1. Game 2 is a similar situation here.
Ben trying to mull over if he has any productive attacks. I have to imagine that it's worth at minimum getting in with Snapcaster Mage, because that's very likely to die on the upkeep when you play no spells.
Yeah.
So trading that in for whatever you can. And Boreless Reckoner is a fairly safe attack as well. So
yeah, the only problem with Boreless Reckoner is the swing back. But I think John is not going to risk Huntmasters into a trade with a Geist who is pretty much worthless at this point.
So both the Huntmasters flip and trigger. I'm going to see what he decides to shoot down. Just going to send Snapcaster, and the second target he's not going to send at the Reckoner, since it's not that productive to do so. And obviously he can't target the Geist, so Snapcaster's down, and 4 damage is dealt to Ben.
What do you think if he... Actually, that wouldn't do too much. He could kill the Reckoner with a 2 damage and then a 1 from the bonfire, or even a 2, and all he would lose would be 1 Huntmaster against an empty board. But John doesn't really need to do anything at this point.
He has Dreadbore in hand, so there's no reason to expend a lot of effort.
Exactly, and even without the Dreadbore, this is just a miserable board state at this point. He's going to play Olivia Voldoran in here, and he's going to have pretty much an army that can't be dealt with by Ben, because now with those flipped Huntmasters, even a Miracle Bonfire won't do it.
Yeah, and he can also just play Scavenging Ooze and Leaf Mana up to disrupt Snapcaster Mage or what have you. I mean,
yeah, there's just endless plays. At this point, Ben is looking at a actual miracle, not a Magikarp miracle.
Yeah.
He needs some kind of divine intervention here. It's hard to win when you're mid-range versus mid-range, and one deck is playing lands and the other one's not.
Well, even saying that aside, I think the particular texture of Ben's cards also lines up very poorly against what Jund is doing.
Right. Geist is pretty garbage in this Jund matchup. Just because, like you said earlier, and even against a Thragtusk, you really can't do much with Geist here.
Yep. John probably double-checking to make sure that he's not exposing himself to a bonfire or something. But the coast is relatively clear with Ben only having the 3 mana.
And he gets to flip Huntmaster's back.
Yep, McCade, and he just shows a hand on the castables, and the draw steps were not being that helpful either. And so
we have another winner here, and John Rolfe is the victor. And we have one match left before we have our top four set, and that is Jesse Hyde versus Devin Weiss.
So, again, we